Today we can continue our adventure with randomized communication protocols. And last time we proved Neumann's theorem, and we know that, well, actually, private and public communication protocols with public and private random bits are, well, almost the same. Now we consider some example where randomized communication protocols are much more effective than usual deterministic protocols. We already know one example, well, two examples. We know that equality can be done in constant number of rounds with public random bits. We also know randomized protocol for greater than function. We consider this protocol on the first lecture. Well, not so good protocol. We consider protocol for log n times log n, but we can improve it. And actually, it's a good exercise for you to improve it. Today, we consider another example, disjointness. But not general disjointness. It seems that general disjointness is hard for randomized settings. But what if we start with a problem that we consider in case of non-deterministic communication? What if we consider disjointness of sets of size at most k? And in this case, surprisingly, we also can prove something. And we can prove that we can do it in O of k number of rounds. It's not trivial result. It's result by Hostad and Wigerson. And we want to prove it now. Let's start with much more trivial protocol, but still interesting. At first, we want to show that randomized communication complexity of disjointness can be bounded by O of 2 to the k. It's exponential in k, it's not so good, but well, it's independent of the length of the string. So there is no dependency on n. That in case of deterministic communication complexity, it's not clear how to achieve it. Surprisingly, we already know how to do this protocol. We did it when we tried to estimate some coverings for this function. What do we know if we have two sets, x and y, and these sets are disjoint? So we have input for our players, x for Alice and y for Bob. And if we know that these sets are disjoint, we can find some separator for these sets. And what is the separator? It's a set that contains x but doesn't contain y. Such that there is no any intersection with y. And if x and y are disjoint, then we always have at least one set S. But moreover, since we know that x and y are small enough, we can say that random separator will separate it with high probability. Probability that random set will separate x and y . This probability is at most 1 over 2k. And why it's true? Because we just need to pick all elements from x and doesn't pick any element from y. And that happens with each element. We pick some element from x with probability 1/2 and doesn't pick element from y also with probability 1/2, and we have 2k conditions, so the final probability will be exactly 1 over 2 to the 2k. Okay. What does it mean? That means that if we pick 2 to the 2k random separators, or times some constant, then with high probability one of this set will be good separator for us. And Chernoff bound will will give lower bound on the error probability. So if we consider like 100 times 2 to the k, random sets. One of it will be separator with probability. Well, we don't need Chernoff bound here. We can use Markov inequality with probability at least 1 minus 1 over 100. Markov inequality. Oh, it's It's good enough protocol since we don't have any dependency on N, but let's try to improve it. What Alice and Bob can do? They can try to use information from common random source. And what's the information can be? Suppose Alice, again, we have some input for both players, for Alice and Bob. And they know sets of separators. Not set of separators, set of random sets. It can be like really long sequence of random sets. What do we know to send to Bob? Okay, no. We want to find some set that contains X. Suppose we know that here some set is I, and X lives inside this set I. If both players knows this set, they can try to use this information. If the set SI will be small enough, like there is no really reason to believe that set SI will be small enough, but suppose it's small enough. Then what can we say about sets Y and X? Well, we can see this picture. So we know that whole X lives here, and there is not so many freedom outside of S because we don't have a lot of elements outside of X. If this set S doesn't contain Y, we have already won. Because if both players know this set, then they can just check that this set is okay for us. But in some cases, we still have some intersection between this set SI and set Y. But what can we say about this intersection? Can it be big? No, because we know that by some magical reasons, this set SI is small enough. So intersection between X and Y will be between SI and Y will be small. And how players can use this information? They can use this information to reduce the size of set Y. Bob can forget about this part of set Y. And the size can only decrease after it. It's an intuition, but let's try to formalize this intuition. We will not think that set I is small enough. We will try to understand probability that intersection between SI and Y is big. We used it only to explain some intuition. So, iterative algorithm. On the first step, we know that size of x plus size of y is less than or equal 2k. It's given for us by some promise. We also assume that x is smaller or length of x is smaller or equal than y. Not length, size. And players can generate the sequence. Up to some number. Sequence of potential separators of size L. We will choose this parameter a bit later. And now what can they do? Alice can try to find the first element Si such that X lives inside set Si. Now only Alice knows this information, but what Alice can do? Alice can send the number of this set, number of this element Si. So it's the first set that contains X, and Alice can send number I to Bob. Now Bob can try to understand, is it true that he has such intersection with this set? Alice sends I to Bob. We need log L number of bits. Okay. Perfect. Bob can try to check, okay, if he doesn't have intersection with set Si, then he can say, oh, perfect, it's one. But usually it's not the case. Usually we have some intersection with set Y. Bob can want to check, is it true that size of intersection between Y and Si is bigger than 3/4 of Y. If yes, they want to say answer is no. Thank you. if you have large intersection with set SI, then we want to say that answer is no. If answer is no, what happens in this case? In this case, we can reduce size of Y. We can throw away all elements outside of set SI. And on this step, Bob sends size of Y. And why do we need to send size of Y on this step? Because in the beginning, we assume that x is less than or size of x is less than or equal than size of y. It's important for our analysis of error probability, and that means that if after this step you throw away too much elements from y, on the next iteration, we need to change roles of players. Okay. Let's try to understand how many bits we need to send at each round. In total, how many rounds do we need to? Oh, actually, in the end, if size of x plus size of y smaller than some constant, big constant, in this case, we just want to run protocol that we created here. Use the protocol. For analysis of error probability, it's important here that we don't want to run this protocol up to sets of size 1, because error will be error on this step will only increase when size of each set is small enough. So we want to stop at some moment, and luckily it's enough to stop that then size of these sets can be bounded by some constant. But it's important that we stop at some big constant and simply run this protocol. 2 to the 2k, it's good for us now, because size of x and size of y can be bounded by this constant. So here we also need to use like constant number of bits. Okay. How many bits we send during this protocol? On each iteration, we either stop or we understand that size of x plus size of y can be we can shrink it to 7/8. Yeah, we multiply this sum by by 7/8 at each iteration. So if you have length less than 2k on the first iteration, on the second iteration, size of x plus size of y will be less than 7/8 times 2k, and so on. So after logarithm in k number of steps, we will reach after logarithm. Yeah, after logarithm number of steps, we will find everything what we want. We will decrease size of two sets to some constant. Okay, on each iteration, we need to exchange log L number of bits, but it's not like the single L for all possible iterations. This L depends on size of L and size of X and size of Y. So in total, we use sum over I log of L of X plus Y times 7/8. This is total number of bits that we exchange in the protocol. Of course, plus some O of log k, log square of k, whatever. Because we have at most log k number of iterations, and here at each iteration, Bob will send log k number of bits to Alice. So it's some additional log square of k number of bits during all iterations. So it's not so much, and we will forget about it. The main thing that we need to use here. In order to understand, we need to understand how we choose this parameter L. And in order to understand it, we try to estimate error probability now. Where we can make a mistake? First situation, then Alice try to find the first set that contains x. Well, maybe in this sequence there is no such element that contains x. First, there is no SI such that SI such that X in SI. Yeah, it's a problem for this protocol. What is the second place where we can make a mistake? This is the second place. If we found some set SI that contains X, well, maybe there is a huge intersection between Y and SI, but yeah, X and Y are still disjoint. It is the second place. Okay. Let's try to understand the the probability that comes from second item. What does it mean? Error probability here means that we choose in this set SI. Here we know only properties about X, that we pick all elements from X. But since X and Y are disjoint, we can estimate this probability by size of Y choose 3/4 of size of Y times 2 to the minus 3/4 of Y. 3/4 of times size of Y. It is at most something to the minus size of y over 20. Yeah, something like that. Probably it will be fine if you put just 20 here. I hope so. Okay. And it's an error probability on the one iteration, and we need to consider sum over all iterations. And here we want to use the fact that size of x is smaller than size of y. That means that since we always deal with invariant that sum of x plus sum of y is smaller than something, but now we have we can bound error probability only in terms of sense of y, and we need to have some bound on the size of y here. As we want to say, we also can say that it's smaller than 2 to the minus size of x plus size of y over 40. That means that sum over all iterations 2 to the minus two k over 40 times 7/8 to the I. Yeah. We need to sum over all i's. Up to number of iterations. We have this sum, and now it's important. It's important that here we want to stop at some moment where the sum is big constant. And why it's important here? We can reverse this sum. We can say that here we have sum where I is, we start from the biggest I, number of iterations, till 1, 2 to the minus 2k over 40 and now it's some geometric series, and since it's geometric series we know how to compute it, and it's bounded by the first element over some constant like that depends only on this parameter, and since the here we stop, then this sum is bigger than some big constant, then we know that this is much smaller than one. Okay. One more time. We start with second case. We try to understand which probability we choose at least 3/4 of elements of Y into our set S, and by union bound we can estimate this probability like size of y, choose 3/4 of size of y times 2^-3/4 of y. And after that, we sum overall iterations of this probability. And here we use the fact that we stop, then this length is still big enough constant. Okay. What is error probability in the first case? If we consider this number of bits that we need to exchange between players, we want to choose L as small as possible. So to reduce the size of the size of bits that we need to exchange between players. But here, error probability will increase if we choose only a small number of separators, because with high probability we will not see anything. So how many iterations do we need? And we need log k iterations. Which probability we can which error probability will be good enough for us on each iteration? Well, if you will have probability 1 over log k, 1 over 10 log k, it will be fine. So with which probability some set will contain x? Some set Si will contain x with probability 1 over 2^k. 2^ of x. That means that if we will choose like L of x plus size of y will be equal to 2^10 size of x, it will be fine for us. And why it will be fine for us? What is the expectation of number of elements, let's try to estimate expectation of number of i's such that x in Si. This expectation is size of L. In our case, it's 2^10 x. Times times the probability 2^-size of k. So expectation will be 2 to the 9 sizes of k. And Chernoff bound says that with high probability the expected number that we will see with high probability we will see number that is not much less than expected number if we choose all sets randomly. So Chernoff bound probability that there is no sets is no sets S I such that X in SI, this probability will be two to the omega of size of X. Yeah, it's actually fine for us. If you want to, if you don't want to continue analysis now, we want to say that, okay, let's here consider not big constant, but log log k. And on each iteration, we will see at least, at most 1 over log k error probability. And at each iteration, we need to exchange this number of, we need to exchange 10 times log of 10 times the size of x number of bits. And that means that here we will see like log sum over 10 size of x's I sum over I 10 like size of x plus size of y times 7 over 8 to the I. It's again geometric series. That means that it's equal to original length times some constant. So it's O of k. It's fine for us. So we are done in this case. We are done with this problem. Actually, this is a randomized protocol, and we know that at each iteration, we need to exchange not so many number of bits. Like here, error may come from two different settings. From the first settings, then there is no good sets for us, and we choose this family of sets to be so large to reduce this probability, and here we also we may estimate probability in terms of current length. Okay, so now we know some upper bounds for randomized protocols, and this bound depends on k. So if k will be linear in terms of n, we cannot prove anything, surprisingly. Can we prove lower bounds on the randomized protocols? And answer is yes. So randomized communication complexity of disjointness without any restriction on the size of X and Y. Randomized communication complexity of disjointness is omega of N. So for disjointness, random bits are not cannot really help us to compute the function. And also important case that even for unique disjointness, it's also linear number of bits we need to exchange. What is the unique disjointness? It is a promise problem. So unique disjointness. So we know that if X and Y are intersected, there is at most one element in the intersection. And now it's really a promise problem. If here we just need to encode our inputs, maybe in a strange way, but here, if we fix X, then the range of Y's depends on this set X, and this dependency is significantly, it's important dependence. So like it looks like this X, Y, and here we have some promise. And we need to solve our problem only on this promise. We don't care about other values. Our goal is to prove this lower bounds. But it's not so easy to do. And before it, we will try to understand why we so care about disjointness, why it's so important. Now I will mostly follow the paper of Georg Petasia . 2014 it called like I don't remember the title of this paper, but it's something about critical block sensitivity, if you want to find it. What is the main result of this paper? we will prove that there are some formulas well there is phi r CNF formulas such that search phi is reducible to not reducible such that it is as hard in terms of randomized settings as unique disjointness. And for which parameter? We probably will show like square root of n. Like n variables. I will reduce this index. But it's not the right bound. In the paper, you can find here something like n over log n. But it's just we just need to find better formula than I will present to you. So the main the technique will be exactly the same, but some properties of the formula can be more tricky to prove if you want to try to find the best known lower bound. What it gives to us, we already know that it gives us estimation on the running time of algorithms. So running time of splitting algorithms. For satisfiability problem. And it also will give us lower bound on the size of monotone formulas. Since it's some relation and we know that monotone Karchmer Wigderson game is a complete relation, so if we can prove it, at the same time we can find some function such that randomized communication complexity of Karchmer Wigderson game for this function will be as hard as randomized communication complexity of search phi. In particular, that means that deterministic communication complexity of this Karchmer-Wigderson game will be big enough. And since deterministic communication complexity of this game will be big enough, then it will give us lower bound on the size of monotone formulas for this function. Okay. Question: why do we need to care about randomized communication complexity here, because for both applications, we need to just understand lower bounds for deterministic communication complexity, and it will be enough for us. Well, two answers for this question. First answer, we have some other applications that is also important, but not so easy to describe them. But also, we will prove it via randomized reduction. So we don't know how to prove this theorem for deterministic protocols. Okay. We need some technical definition in the beginning. It's critical block sensitivity. At first, what is the block sensitivity of a function? Suppose we have some Boolean function. It's not necessary as Boolean values to some set Z. For each input, let x0 0 to the n, for each input we try to understand the value of this function, the value on this input, and we try to understand how many ways do we have to change the value of this function. We want to flip some bits of x0 such that the value of function function will also flip. So we can represent x0 as a string, and we want to consider some disjoint partition on blocks. It's not disjoint partition. It's partition except some path. We want to extract some disjoint blocks. For this input x0, so this will be block b1, block b2, block b3. It's some subsequence. It's not necessarily consecutive, but we can just pick any subsequence of coordinates. And we want to have the following property, that if we flip all elements inside some block, then we change the value of the function. It's some generalization of usual sensitivity of the function. Usual sensitivity means that we can flip just one input bit, and we try to count number of bits that we can flip such that the value will change. But here we can flip not only one bit, we can flip the whole block. And the block sensitivity in the point x0 of the function f is maximum overall choices of blocks such that f of for all bi It's block sensitivity of a function. What is the critical block sensitivity? Critical block sensitivity is a generalization of it, but for relations. First of all, if you have some relation like x, y, not x, y. You want to find some critical points. And what is the critical point of the relation? It's a point where we have exactly one answer. So critical point. Of S is a point. Why such that there is unique there is a unique C such that X Y C inside the set S. Yeah. Well, if you consider search phi problem, so we have unsatisfied CNF formula, and if we pick random point, like a random assignment to the variables, random assignment will unsatisfy a lot of clauses actually. Like, if you consider random free CNF formula and if you pick random assignment, that means that each clause will not be satisfied with probability 1/9, and it means that the whole 1/9 fraction of all clauses will not be satisfied by a random assignment. Oh, not 1/9, 1/8, 1/8 number of clauses will not be satisfied by a random assignment. That means that random point is not critical. So critical point is the point where we have only one answer. So only one clause is not satisfied in the critical point. And we also can consider some restrictions of the relation S to a function. That means that for each input we choose only one output somehow. So critical block sensitivity of relation S, it is maximum over all functions. That are restriction of the relation S. Oh, not maximum, sorry. It's minimum over all functions. Minimum over all functions. Maximum overall sorry. We consider not relation on pair of inputs, it's just relation on one input. Point X. Maximum overall axis, but only overall critical axis. Of block sensitivity of a function f in the point x0. So we consider the worst restriction, overall possible restrictions of a relation S, and for the worst restriction we choose the best point, the point with biggest block sensitivity. Okay, well, and in fact, we want to prove the following theorem. Randomized communication complexity of search phi is at least as randomized omega of randomized communication complexity of disjointness on the critical block sensitivity of search phi. That unique disjointness. Okay, it's not the first paper when then people try to do it. There are some paper with similar connections for functions and sensitivity measure, but for relations and critical block sensitivity, originally it was proved. No. We want to prove it only for tricky formulas. There is phi such that it's not the only phi. We will show how to modify our original formula phi such that it will satisfy this theorem. So it will not be true for all possible formulas phi, but for any, we can pick any formula phi, modify it a little bit, and it will be true after. Originally, it was done in the paper by Hoon Nordstrom. Where they defined critical block sensitivity, but they directly proved lower bound for the search phi, and they used some information complexity for it. But we will do it by proving some reduction, and in some sense it's much simpler. Okay, before we start to prove this theorem, so we don't have much time for proof, since it's better to consider formulas for which it is true. For which formulas we can prove lower bound on the critical block sensitivity? We want to show that if we consider Zetian formula. What is Zetian formula? We have some graph. And variables of this formula corresponds to edges. So for each edge, we have variable xe. And we have some label at each vertex of this graph. It's either 0 or 1. And we want to write a linear system that says that parity of all incident edges are equal to the label on the vertex. So for all v, we want to write that sum over f2 of xe and it's not so hard to understand if sum over all labels, if you have connected graph and sum over all labels are odd, then this formula is not satisfied. It's not satisfiable. But it's defined by graph. First lemma. If this graph is k-rotable, then critical block sensitivity of such phi is at most k. If g is k-rotable, then G, then critical block sensitivity of search of setting formula based on this graph is at least K. What is K-routable? K-routable means that in our graph we can find a set of vertices of size 2k such that for any we have size of set of size 2k such that for any pairing of these vertices we can find disjoint paths that connect these pairs. So we have 2k vertices, some fixed set in the graph, and our opponent will give you like set of pairs in this set. And after that, your goal is to find h disjoint paths that connects these pairs. And if you can find it, so we will call this graph K-routable. And the claim that if graph is K-routable, then critical block sensitivity is big enough. Do we have any K-routable graphs? Answer is yes. And it's not so hard to find if we consider just a grid. Just a grid on size 2k. Well, we can say that perfect. Let's say that this will be our witness, just a single row. It will be or a single column, whatever. I draw a single column. It will be a witness that this graph is K-routable. Yes, indeed. If our opponent will give us set of pairs here, it should be 2k. Should be even number. Then for each pair, we can find some level here. For example, for this pair, we want to use this level. And we draw path to this level and connect it here. For this pair, we want to use this level. So we draw our path up to this level and connect it here. This path will be H disjoint. That is not so hard to see. Okay, so we have to finish now. Next time we will try to understand that K-routable is enough to show lower bound on the critical block sensitivity, and we will prove this theorem. So, yeah, thank you.